An academic redcoat responds to the Tea Party. At the launch of Anthony J. Hall's Earth into Property. Ben McNally's bookstore on Bay Street in Toronto, Ontario, Canada. November 2nd, 2010.
So let's move beyond the Hollywood stereotypes of cowboys and Indians. Think redcoats and Indians. You know, redcoats. British soldiers, Northwest Mounted Police, RCMP. Let's go back to the siècle des Lumières, the Enlightenment, the 18th century, the time of the Seven Years' War, or as it's remembered in the United States, the French and Indian War. Why the French and Indian War? Well, the enemies were the French and the Indians. Was the founders of Canada. Let's go back to the time of the Boston Tea Party, which we'll be hearing a lot about tonight. The American Revolution, the French Revolution. I really want to throw in the Haiti slave revolt, Toussaint Louverture and all that. He figures centrally in the book. And the War of 1812. Let's try to understand our own history here in York, here in the capital of Upper Canada. The British colony founded by William Johnson's son, and that, by the way, is William Johnson, and it's not accidental that he's right behind me as I'm speaking. William Johnson's son, John Johnson, he wrote the report that resulted in the division of Quebec into Upper Canada and Lower Canada, which is now, of course, Ontario and Quebec. Let's try to understand the Indigenous conservatism on which both French Aboriginal Canada and British Imperial Canada are founded. So that's my term for tonight, Indigenous conservatism. Let's contemplate the Aboriginal conservatism of our home and native land. Let's think about the significance of Toronto's, Ontario's, and Canada's Iroquoian names. I'm going to try to sum up 16 years of work in a very few phrases here. So here's the meat of the matter, and I'll try to be as expeditious as possible, but I am a professor and I'm used to pontificating a little bit, so I'll try to be gentle with you. In both volumes of The Bowl with One Spoon, I try to tell a global story of imperial expansion and Aboriginal pushback, colonization and decolonization. I begin the narrative of globalization's modern era in 1492. That was the year Christopher Columbus inaugurated a new world order. One that continues yet in the constant invention and reinvention of the Americas as a promised land for immigrants and their descendants. The other side of the invention of America as a new world has been the military, legal, cultural, and psychological assaults on the old world civilizations of indigenous peoples of this hemisphere. Together, these processes form a core component in the genesis of global capitalism. Let's try to move beyond the collective amnesia on which global capitalism depends. Let's try to remember who lost and who gained from the commodification and privatization of such massive portions of the Earth's natural resources. The globalization of capitalism has created this unprecedented moment in human history. Never before have all the world's nations, peoples, and cultures been pressed into the mold of a single political economy, a single worldwide market. How has the globalization of this economic monoculture affected our democratic rights and responsibilities when all the world's people live or die based on their ability to survive in a single regime of capitalist interaction? Where's the democratic choice in this all-encompassing system? What is it about this economic monoculture of mind and matter that made the entire global community so vulnerable to the financial debacle that began in 2008 and plagues us yet? In trying to address big questions such as these, I introduced a host of new terms, like the Colombian conquest, or the privatized terror economy, or anti-imperial globalization, or the national security state. In my effort to explain the politics of decolonization, I give widened usage to the fourth world, the term introduced in 1974 by the shoe swap sage George Manuel in his effort to explain the underlying philosophies of the Non-Aligned Movement and the World Council of Indigenous Peoples. And I hope you'll be interested to learn more about the Non-Aligned Movement and the World Council of Indigenous Peoples in the books. This has a lot to do with the history of this UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, which the government of Canada, unlike the vast majority of countries in the world, has not ratified. But my aim in the Bowl Project, as widened now with the publication of Earth and Property, is to describe the process of globalization since 1492 in ways that afford careful attention to the myriad perspectives of colonizers and the colonized, of empire builders, and of those seeking liberation from imperialism in all its many manifestations. While the larger framework of my oeuvre is global, however, I put North American history at the very center of my narrative. I highlight particularly how the encounters between indigenous people and Anglo-American builders of European, national, and corporate empires explain much about the character of Canada and the United States right up to today. As I see it, Canada emerged from the conservative side of a civil war in the British Empire. In the course of this civil war, bookmarked by the American Revolution and the War of 1812, the secessionists succeeded in gaining international recognition for their new world polity, and that new world polity is the United States of America. In breaking from the British Empire, the founders of the Republic to the South gave free rein to their personality as Indian fighters. Alternatively, their conservative opponents, the founders of our country, sought to win the attachment of Indians based on principles of alliance, consent, the rule of law, and treaty federalism. The key to implementing this more enlightened approach, however incomplete and unrealized, lay in the Royal Proclamation of 1763, the constitutional instrument that formed the basis of British Imperial Canada, and I believe forms the constitutional basis of Canada to this day. Like the instruments of law that advanced the abolition of slavery, the prohibition of genocide, the universality of human rights, the Royal Proclamation figures centrally in the history of international law. In Canada, the Royal Proclamation is still working its way into the body politic in our constitutional recognition and affirmation of Aboriginal and treaty rights. This affirmation in Section 35 of the Constitution Act 1982 is being expressed, for instance, in the negotiation of 50 or so Crown Aboriginal treaties presently being hammered out with the Indigenous peoples of British Columbia. As I see it, a core question raised in Anglo-America's era of civil war is whether conquest or consent, genocide or accommodation, would govern the colonizer's treatment of indigenous peoples in North America. As I elaborate in much detail throughout both volumes of the Bowl Project, the United States was established through its founders' embrace of conquest as a core ideal of the Imperial Republic. The current implications of this embrace are currently ascertainable in the justifications and course of the 9/11 wars, as directed primarily